yeah.
Whew. When Arthur was trying to pull the sword away from the rock, he applied a tension force to the sword. If that force was large enough to cause a failure of the system, three things could have happened. So first, the friction between the sword and the rock fails and the sword slips out of the rock, which is what happened in the story, so we will teach the wizard Merlin a good lesson in this video. Second, the rock mass fails and pulls out of the surrounding rock, forming a cone failure. And third, the sword itself breaks under the tension load. If the wizard Merlin was a structural engineer, he would have embedded the sword an adequate length into the rock so that the only possible failure mode would be the fracture of the sword. He would also make a sword with ridges like or deformed bars. And if he was a hardcore engineer, he would have even cogged the tip of the sword. Not very efficient in a battle though. Now let's get back to reality. Those three mechanisms of failure apply to reinforcement bars embedded into a mass of concrete. If the pull-out force is high enough and the friction between the rebar and the concrete fails, the bar will slip out of the concrete. Or the concrete mass fails and pulls out a cone of concrete, which is called a cone failure. And lastly, the rebar breaks under the tension load. The distance the reinforcement goes into the concrete is called development length, and the failure types that could happen are dependent on the development length. We structural engineers often specify full development length, which means the strength of the connection between the bar and the concrete is at its highest, and the only way that the connection can fail is by breaking the reinforcement bar. With full development length, you will not see a cone failure or a failure of the friction between the bar and the concrete. But what if you don't have enough mass of concrete to embed the rebar? Well, you have a couple of options. First, you should be using a deformed bar which has ribs or ridges. These ribs increase the contact surface area between concrete and steel and also increase the friction coefficient of the interface between steel and concrete. This means that a shorter embedment length is required for a deformed bar if compared to a smooth surface round bar or a sword. Typically, plain bars need a 50% longer development length, not to mention that deformed bars are typically stronger than round smooth bars. In Australia, most round bars are 250 MPa, while deformed bars are 500 MPa. Second option is that you can use standard hooks or cogs. AS3600 clause 13.1.2.6 allows the development length of a bar with standard hook or cog to be reduced to half of the full development length. And lastly, another alternative is to use a larger number of smaller bars if there is available space. For example, a N20 bar to be full developed must be embedded 900 millimeters into a 25 MPa concrete. Suppose you don't have 900 millimeters available. You can use 2N16s instead, because N16s require 700 millimeters development length. Remember, smaller bars achieve a higher value of bond stress, and we will talk about this in the end of the video when we calculate the K2 factor to work out development length according to AS3600. So stick until the end of the video. But before we proceed with the video, I've got some great updates about our upcoming online webinar on space gas for commercial structures. I finally got a hold of a speaker. I wanted someone who not only knows a lot about commercial structure and space gas, but also loves teaching and mentoring. It's going to be a fantastic learning opportunity for engineers like you. We're still working on finalizing the date, so we will let you know more details soon. If you want to be part of this mentorship session, we've made a special WhatsApp group just for those who want to participate. You will find the link to join the group in the description below. Now that we understand the whole concept of embedment length, let's have a look at real life situations where we must take that into account. The first most obvious scenario that comes up to my mind are the starter bars coming out of footings. If the footings are subjected to uplift or bending moment, typically the full tensile development length must be achieved for the starter bars. We usually cog the reinforcement to achieve a 0.5 times development length. There's also a compressive development length that we haven't discussed in this video, and if you want to know more about this, you can check out my pad footing video. Another case that I often see engineers missing is the development length of the footing reinforcement. If you watch my pad footing video, you should know that we typically design the footing as a cantilever beam in bending from a distance to the face of the column. Therefore, we need a footing size large enough to achieve full development length. Which leads us to our next example, which is a simple cantilever beam. We must develop the bars into the support and also into the cantilever direction. Another good example is on joints in concrete slabs. You gotta make sure the development and the lapping length is sufficient. There's also stairs. Stairs are designed as a suspended slab with the throat thickness being the thickness of the slab. And they're commonly poured with the floor above, therefore in some case you could have a construction joint here and enough lapping and development length must be achieved. Another good example is on steps. So imagine you have a situation where a cantilever balcony has to be stepped like this. You will have to comply with the development length for the top bars into the throat of the step. And this is very important because it typically governs the design of cantilever balconies, especially if you can't increase the thickness of the throat due to architectural reasons. And I find this example a bit harder to visualize because you have to anticipate where the cracks may occur. And the same happens for steps of beams. The development length will probably dictate the width of the downturn. Now let's get down to the fun stuff, right? Let's have a look at some numbers. So for a preliminary design, an estimate of the development length can be 40 times the bar diameter. The exact number can be calculated from AS3600 clause 13.1.2.2. So the K1 is the bar location factor or depth factor. It accounts for plastic settlement, segregation, and bleeding of concrete, which reduces the effective contact area between concrete and the reinforcement. So K1 can be 1.3 or 1. Anytime that you have horizontal bars with more than 300 millimeters of concrete below, K1 is equal to 1.3. K2 is the bar diameter factor, which relates to bone stress, which I mentioned in the beginning of the video. So smaller bars have higher bone stress, therefore K2 is higher for smaller bars. Hence, the development length is smaller because K2 is in the denominator of the equation. And finally, K3 is the cover and bar spacing factor, and it's within 0.7 and 1. And if you use clause 13.1.2.3, you might be able to reduce this number to 70% of the development length by introducing the factors K4 and K5. Okay, now that you understand the basics, we can simplify this process by establishing a simple way to calculate development length, which is exactly what you're going to do when you start working for an engineering firm in real life. You will have too many numbers to crush in a full design, so you want to try to optimize your calculations as much as possible. So first, let's take K1 and K3 as 1 and substitute K2 for the formula 132 minus diameter of the bar divided by 100, and then we get this formula. And now we can solve this equation and create tables for different bar diameters and concrete strength. On my pad footing video, I gave you a table from N12 to N32 bars for 25 MPa concrete, but I've also prepared a PDF with these tables for various bars and concrete strength, which is in the link in the description below. You can download it for free. And finally, another point that I wanted to quickly touch upon is clause 13.1.2.4 on development length. To develop less than the yield strength, you don't always have to use full development length. You can calculate the stresses on the bar and use the embedment length accordingly. Just be careful with pull-out cone failure because AS3600 does not give much guidance on it. If you enjoyed this content, please like and share the video. Don't forget to join the WhatsApp group for the seminar. And if you want to learn how to design a pad footing Watch these two videos here, and I'll see you there.